generalnie właśnie jak definiować szybkość w przeliczeniu na realne zyski, jakie możemy pozyskać z prowadzenia naszej strony, udostępniania naszej treści. I jak dowiemy się, jak to mierzyć, to potem dowiemy się właśnie, jak się przygotować na to. I Iwan nam opowie o tym, jak skonfigurować naszego WordPressa, jak możemy to zrobić właśnie, żeby on ładował się co najmniej z prędkością Warp 9. Także oddaję już głos Iwanowi.
Well, first of all, thanks a lot for coming here. I'm very glad that I have a privilege to speak to you here today about website speed and WordPress speed in general. The main reason I'm here is because I've been in WordPress since 2008 now, and during my WordPress journey I had a lot of opportunities to host and manage a lot of WordPress websites. In fact, as you might know, I'm currently Chief Operations Officer of ManageWP, which is a WordPress management dashboard, the first one of its kind, and the product that currently manages over 250,000 WordPress websites all around the world. Before working for ManageWP, I had the opportunity to work with many WordPress and non-WordPress businesses that are heavily affected by speed. For a short while before ManageWP, I worked for a CDN provider called MaxCDN, and before that I worked for a hosting company that offered its services to a lot of different businesses that are really reliant on scalability, high availability and speed, such as the London Stock Exchange, the National Bank of England, the Reuters, and a lot of different GPS companies that relied heavily on speed and availability of their resources to bring their products to the market. Now, the thing we are going to be talking about today is how important website speed, or WordPress speed in this case, is to your business in general. How many people here actually live from their WordPress websites? Okay, so maybe 10%, but still a lot of you are using WordPress, and 10% people actually living from it is quite a big number. When I came to ManageWP to work for this company a bit more than 3 years ago, I was in charge of our infrastructure, and I was in charge also of the technical support, so I had a lot of chances to talk to our customers and see the issues they were facing with their website speed, their hosting providers, their bandwidth usage, team usage, and the way that they use WordPress in general was sometimes extraordinarily good and sometimes really poor. So one of the things that we learned over time using internet, not just us but everyone, is that if you have 1 second in delay in loading your WordPress website, it can actually lower your revenue, or actually your conversions for your sales department, by 7%. This is from a study done by Google. There is also a different study done by Amazon in 2009 that says that over 50% of people accept their website to load in under 2 seconds. If it doesn't, they usually click another tab, try to open another browser window, do something else. And is this the reality, or you know, are software companies just trying to sell us more optimization, sell us better resources, faster internet? Well, I'm going to talk about that a little in terms of what the big players are doing. Google announced a couple of years ago and took into account your website speed as one of the most important metrics when it comes to actually rating your website on search engines. So your website speed is actually probably one of the surest things you can do in order to boost your revenue and sales. Why am I saying this? Because it will also improve your rankings, it will improve your conversions, and in general make user experience for your clients much better. We had our fair share of issues with this, and I'm going to show a small problem that we were able to encounter that in one day cost us a significant amount of money. It was the 15th September, 1 year ago, so almost exactly a year ago. I just came back from my vacation, and I was actually pretty happy because I was just on a vacation. It was really nice. I managed to rest myself, and we were planning to deploy a new technology of ManageWP. Because at the start of ManageWP in 2011, we basically ran everything on one box. You just had a talk about you know, the availability of WordPress and everything, so you have additional ways to understand why it's running on one box with redundancy, but still one box, very bad. We had just one server serving both our database and our front-end and back-end code. And we basically relied just on that server and had our fair time of website issues whenever our hosting provider had problems or when something happened. So we were working on that, and we decided to implement another solution which costed a lot of money to implement. Well, not a lot of money, a couple of $1,000s in terms of new machines and everything. But it was a significant investment in some way, in our time and our resources to get it out to the public. And we decided to put in a load balancer based on HA proxy, high availability proxy, which was supposed to do the caching, the offloading of SSL and other stuff that production servers didn't have to do, and we had a check for our database consistency. We put it in two different data centers in the planet, or now SoftLayer, and we hoped it would work beautifully. It was tested in the user acceptance tests, it was tested on staging, and it really, you know, improved the user experience. Except when we actually rolled it out, it didn't really work. And this is what happened. When you look at the same numbers from a week ago, at the moment we roll out this wonderful idea about improving our website experience, we actually started losing customers. People started not going to ManageWP or not staying on ManageWP for a long time. And we quickly noticed that, but it took us maybe an hour to actually realize what was going on. And by that time, we basically lost half of our revenue and half of our visits for that day. And ManageWP is a big website, as I said. It has around 80,000 registered users, around 6,000 people pay for it now. Back then, it was maybe around 5,000. And this was basically 50% of that day's revenue lost, a couple of $1,000s, by the technology that we, you know, used our time and money to implement, and it obviously didn't work at the moment. What happened was that actually the load time of the server went from around 1 second, the response time of the server, to about 4 seconds. And the reason for this was actually in the HA proxy. We had an issue that didn't happen in our staging area, and that was the situation where HA proxy, which was also load balanced and had its own setup, had problems resolving first byte time. Why did it have this problem? Well, the issue was that back in Nginx 1.56, you had an issue where if the SSL, you know, the certificate that is there for your security and everything, it has to have two HTTP requests in order to serve the content after that. And actually, if the certificate is larger than 4 kilobytes, in older versions of Nginx, as I mentioned, it required 3 trips. So we used a technology, we knew about that, and we used a technology called fake first byte in a way, where you start serving content before all of these trips are made. However, in this version of HA proxy that we used, our configuration triggered the bug, which is now fixed, but at that point we were able to have a problem, and we had to wait for all of these round trips of SSL handshake to happen in order to start serving content. So this happened, and first by time went way up, and at the same moment when that happened, our revenue and our customer satisfaction obviously plummeted. People weren't coming to support. They didn't tell us they are, you know, having some issues. We just noticed that they are leaving the website, and it took us an hour to figure out what was going on. Another hour to fix it. And at the same moment when we fixed the issue with the page loading time, everything went back to normal. So the magnitude of a website speed importance at that point was probably the most clear to me at that point, because everything was almost instant. People were instantly deciding to leave, and people were instantly using the website in the old way again. It was an expensive lesson in a way, but it was a really good lesson for us to start thinking about this and working on this more. So what happened is, as I said, when everything returned to normal, we started making money and doing business as usual, but we invested a lot of time to create a new server setup to avoid all of these issues, and we are doing it a bit differently now on ManageWP. Some of you already know, because I already met with some of our users here, that we also decided to build ManageWP from scratch, with the main emphasis given to performance and speed and reliability, and this is ManageWP Orion, which is currently in closed beta. And if someone wants to try it, he can. But this is, as I said, brought us to think about the importance of speed even more than before. And the first thing that you need to think about when you are thinking about WordPress speed is how to measure it. There are external tools that are free that you can go to the website and use. You can use pingdom.com, which has a tool for measuring speed, and also it can measure your speed on a daily basis if you give them around $15 per month. And also there is Webpage Test, which is also a really important tool that is governed by a lot of different companies and CDNs that want to increase internet speed as their mission statement. There are also other tools such as Google Page Speed. Also, you can use server-side tools like New Relic, and you can also use even Google Analytics, like I just showed that we used to see that an issue was happening at that point. But there are also different things you should think about. There are plugins that will help you measure your plugin speed and their execution, such as P3 or the plugin that does performance testing for other WordPress plugins. And you have a number of query optimizers for WordPress, and some of them are actually free, and you can just download them as plugin and use. I did a small test on Pingdom with my personal blog. It now loads in less than 0.4 seconds, and we are able to hover it around 0.3 by using a couple of different technologies. The thing, how do we do this? Well, you have to choose your stack carefully. We use HHVM with MariaDB as MySQL drop-in. It has a really nice MySQL query feature. And HHVM is the alternative to PHP, which was basically a fork of PHP done by Facebook. At one point it was almost 20 times faster than PHP. Now the speed difference is much lower. because PHP with PHP 7 did a lot of improvements. You will see a lot of tests saying that it's around 18% difference in terms of speed now in favor of HHVM, but there are a lot of tests saying it's less than 10 and around 7%. 80% speed increase tests are mostly copied over from HHVM blog now, so expect in 2 months when, I think it's 12th November when PHP 7 comes out, that HHVM and PHP 7 will probably be similar in speed. And WordPress has a plan about supporting PHP 7 from the start. There is an issue with this, and that is that a lot of WordPress themes and WordPress plugins probably won't support PHP 7, and some plugins and themes still have issues with HHVM because there are some PHP functions that HHVM does not support. And WordPress also has a backward compatibility trend dating to PHP 5.2, so there are some you know, backward reliability things in WordPress that are making the adoption a bit slower. But anyway, the good news about this is that HHVM or PHP 7 can be easily used as the first option, but you can have a fallback option like regular PHP 5.6 or PHP FPM, and the delay between HHVM and the PHP 7 switching over to PHP 5.6, if the function is not supported, is around 100 milliseconds, so it's not that big of a deal breaker. Second thing I just mentioned, this is basically the benchmark that OpenLightSpeed, which is currently considered the best benchmark that was done, and the most unbiased one was. And you can see the number of requests and the speed that we had with HHVM, PHP 7, and the current stable version of PHP. Second thing, caching is extremely important. You can use different tools for this. You can use your own server cache and database cache, as I mentioned with MariaDB. We cache our stuff currently with Varnish and Memcached. And we have our own custom setup for that. We use also Redis for some things. And we also use Cloudflare for DNS management and some part of you know, SSL offloading. And we also use MaxCDN, which I also mentioned before, in order to serve static content to our clients from the nearest server to them. There are many reasons why caching can be important, but it can also be really bad. Of course, serving static HTML with Varnish is always the fastest way in terms of you actually, you know, serving HTML instead of waiting for PHP response. But the issue is that there are a lot of cases like with WooCommerce or e-commerce plugins and themes where you don't want to have your backend cached, or you don't even want to have your front-end cached. So you have to take, you know, the pros and cons and work on your own setup that is compatible with your theme or WordPress setup in order to achieve maximum results. The next thing is that you have to be really careful when you're choosing your theme. And there are a lot of themes where I had a chance to see WordPress actually making 50 to 100 database queries in order to just serve one page of content. And the issue is this, with this is quite big, you know, if you're waiting for your Apache or Nginx server or for your database and PHP to serve that content that needed that many queries, you're probably going to be in big trouble. The theme that I used for my website has around 20 queries in order to display every one of its pages, so it added to the speed a lot. There is no real good alternative right now for the quality of code. You can cache a lot of things on the server level, but bad code will in the end stay bad code. So that is something you should always you know, think about when you are purchasing a team. There are actually tools you can use to test teams before the purchase. If you look through WordPress.org, you will see some of these plugins that are basically benchmarking demo versions of teams, and you can use some of them. But the situation where you are most likely to gain is to have a good company specialized in these things to do it for you. And you should try, you know, using specialized companies to build your website, to basically run your hosting. If that business is critical enough money-wise for you, there are many things you can do yourself, like such as minimizing pictures and etc. If some of you here are perhaps in front-end design, you know what things like spriting are, what concatenation is, what is minimizing your JavaScript and your CSS is. And the reason these things exist is because HTTP 1.1 that we use today was basically built in 1997. And they didn't have these problems back then, and they didn't have a lot of really great things, and of course they didn't think about WordPress then either. So in any way, a lot of these things are going to go away as front-end technologies once HTTP2 comes out, because it solves the problems such as serving maximum of two requests via HTTP from one domain to the end user, etc. And that is something that's going to be done in parallel by default in HTTP2. But in HTTP1, a good programmer will use these front-end techniques. Use the CDN in a good way in order to serve content from multiple subdomains, and in order to deliver your website really fast. Why am I saying this? Especially because I believe a lot of you aren't programmers. The main point behind this part of the presentation is to make you think about the companies you're choosing, and try choosing the ones that are keeping up with the technology. Try choosing companies that are going to try HHVM, PHP 7, HTTP2, try different kind of caching or build their own cache. Try these companies because they are the ones that are going to be flexible in terms of providing you the expert experience to use your website quickly. And the other classical hosting providers and other companies that are, you know, still just using PHP 5.2, Apache and MySQL are going to have a lot of problems adjusting and keeping up the pace with the pace of the web, which is currently evolving all the time. So this was something I wanted to, you know, move your attention to for a little bit, put an emphasis on website speed, and if you have any questions, this is a good time to ask them, or me and Davor, which is my colleague, which will be talking after this about customer support, are going to be around the hall, and you can, you know, just ask us then. But if you have any questions now, I will be happy to answer.
Są jakieś pytania?
Okay, well then thanks a lot. If you have any other questions after, I will be available to help.
Dzięki. No dobra, to co? Jeszcze jedna prezentacja przed obiadem. #burger taki dobry.
Tak.
Jeszcze na prezentacja przed obiadem. Food truck już są podstawione, więc jak ktoś jest mocno głodny, to może już iść. Z takich ogłoszeń kolegialnych powstanie tam jobbot gdzieś w okolicach Wind, tak że będzie można umieścić na przykład ogłoszenie o tym, że szukacie kogoś do zlecenia lub że na przykład jesteście gotowi do wynajęcia siebie. Zachęcam.
A następna prezentacja o 12.45.